Hi everyone, this is the old man at Golden Girls of Westeros, and I thank you for coming out and visiting us tonight. Tonight we have our ladies of gold, Ashley, Lady Marie, Lady Steffi, and we have a guest tonight. We have Sword in the Darkness, and we'll give her, she's our guest, we'll give her the first chance to introduce herself, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about her latest video once all the other girls have introduced themselves. Go ahead, Miss Sword.
Sword in the Darkness. I have been a fan of Game of Thrones for a while. I actually started watching the show before I read the books, and then once I started reading the books, I just zipped right through them. And I'm back to about, I'm read the first two or three a bunch of times, but I'm the last two again. But I like to read things. I like to find the mysteries in there and try to solve them the best I can. And that's basically why I do videos.
Okay, is that it?
That's it.
All right. Ashley, you want to introduce yourself, huh?
I would love to. Hi, everyone. I'm the Iron Underneath, Lady Ashley. So nice to be here. I missed last week. I missed you all so much. And I'm excited to meet Sword in the Darkness and listen to your theory. I'm really excited. Thanks again for having me, ladies.
You're one of us. Marie?
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's nice to be here. And yes, I think I persuaded... Oh, no, Sword asked me if she could do a vid, and we're really pleased to have her here tonight because I think she makes some excellent points, some good ideas. And everyone visit her link because she's got some more videos there. And I know how hard it is to do a video now. It takes lots of hours, lots of prep. So everyone visit Sword's channel and Ashley's and anyone else who has a YouTube channel out there. Thanks very much. And Steffi, would you like to say a few words?
Hi, everybody. Felicia, thanks for coming. I can't wait to discuss your theory, Faye. I watched it so many times today. I'm into it, and thanks for having me on, ladies.
Okay, we're going to try to... We may go a little bit longer tonight. I think Ashley has a little bit she can talk about. But we're going to start first with Faye. With Sword. And I'll let you tell us what you think of what your theory's about. Okay?
Okay. Faye's fine, by the way. That is actually my name, Faye. It has to do with the Crypts of Winterfell. I've seen a lot of videos, and I went back and watched a lot more when I was getting this ready. And there's a lot of theories out there. And I think all of them are it. I saw everything from Rhaegar's harp to a marriage cloak to a letter to... the dragon, and even saw a video about the Great Other, which I'm going to go back and rewatch that again because it was kind of interesting, actually. And this is just something that I was thinking about in terms of what would be most advantageous to Jon Snow and what could possibly be there that would be to his advantage, and just some of the things that he says, and well, the fact that there has to be something important there because all of the Starks, Sansa, I think, and of course we don't have a point of view from Rob, but dream about the Crypts or think about the Crypts, or in a lot of cases dread them, don't like them. So their importance is obvious, but, and then also the fact that there's never any more mention of Rhaegar's body once it's there at the Trident, once he's dead. And if, I believe that Ned knew how they felt. This is, again, assumptions on my part. I believe that Ned knew that there was a relationship there, knew how much Lyanna cared about. It just would be the kind of person that would want to not just leave his body laying there, to do something with it. And I also don't believe that Aerys was the type of person that would have returned bones. There's no mention really of Brandon's bones coming home. He just doesn't seem the type of person that would be all, okay, let's do the right thing and send the bones home. So if there's something in there, I just think it could be his body and in his dented rubyless armor, sorry about that, it would just seem like a good clue. And that's really all, basically, is that I think there's a possibility that in the crypts that could point to John's heritage, that would be one of them. I mean, Bran can see things, but who's gonna really believe him? I mean, some people will, yes, but who else would really actually believe him? Number one. And number two, even if Helen Reed, he plays another part in that. I think if Ned trusted anybody to see that the bones got to Winterfell, it would be him. So think that that's who has Ned's bones, because they haven't gotten past Moat Cailin, and you would think that somebody would have found him there, and he would be the person who could hide them, but that's a whole other story. I just feel like Ned talks about having a living his lies, and it seems to me that would be a big one. And really, that's about it. That's the essence of the theory, anyway.
Well, you know, you do have Jon Snow has a dream of himself wearing black armor and using a fiery sword. And I was just wondering if it is Rhaegar, or if he, you know, did Ned at least get the armor? If, you know, if he got the body and the armor, but whatever, that could be, in a way, it could be, you're right, Steffi. And I'll let Steffi go on with her thought there. That's a good thought there.
Yeah, it's in the Winds of Winter release of Aaron Dampier's chapter. Euron is wearing the cold dark steel. It's almost black, right? Most Valyrian blades are, but its armor is as well. And I think this is a great point for your theory as well, that there must be some sort of picture of Azor Ahai or the Prince that was promised, or some kind of figure, in order for Rhaegar to wear this armor, and then for, like, just to wear it all the time, and then for Jon to further see it later on, like, on himself at the wall with a flaming sword in hand. That was my point.
Ashley, you got something to say? I like the point, the book part where you quoted where Ned came up to the Trident. Where was? Do you remember where that was at? What that was in? Faye?
That would have been in the first book, in a Game of Thrones.
Yeah, that's a good point, because if he was there and he came up, then like you said in your video, there would have been a lot of people running for the rubies, not paying much attention to Rhaegar. Ladies?
Yeah, I think so. I think Robert was wounded and everybody was worried about him. Once he killed Rhaegar, Rhaegar's own troops would have been, well, scattered, disheartened, leaderless, basically. And then everybody, it says from both sides, were in the river looking for the rubies. So it would have been hectic. It would have been chaotic. Nobody would have been really paying any attention to what was going on. I think that they would pay attention to Rhaegar, but if they were more concerned about the rubies and saving their own skin, who knows?
But going back to the crypts, I have heard theories that perhaps the Night Queen is there. But also what interests me in the show, and I'm going back to the show here, is the way that Dan and Dave, and they would have been really specific about how Lyanna's statue would look, because she's so important to the story of Jon. She's got one hand outstretched and one hand pointing back. And I'd love to know where that hand is pointing back to. And also there was a point about Bran. Don't let her leave me. Don't let me have a senior moment. Bran goes down to those crypts and he goes through specific things of each thing to Osha. And I'm thinking there's got to be a reason why he's going through all the crypts and mentioning every single person to Osha that has died there, and they've got the swords there. And another thing that struck me too was the vengeful spirits. And I'm thinking, why would they be vengeful if they've died in battle or something like that? Why would they be vengeful? Because everyone falls in battle. Well, not everyone, but a lot of people fall in battle, but they don't come back vengeful spirits. So I'm thinking there's got to be a reason why those swords are across their laps, so that their vengeful spirits can't be released. But I just thought it's interesting that her statue seems to be one hand open and one hand pointing back. Is she saying, like, in order to know the future, you have to come forward and then go back? A little bit like what Danny says, to go further, you must don't look back or something. I kind of get muddled up with the books there and the show.
Dany keeps telling herself if she looks back, she's lost. But then the to go east, you must go west. To go west, you must go east. To go north, you must go south, and so on and so forth. But she keeps telling herself over and over, if I look back, I'm lost.
I just want to point out really quick what I found really interesting about when Daenerys is saying that if she looks back, she's lost. Jon is at the same time, I believe, and he's explaining to him, eldlings, eat with them, drink with them, be with them. Repeating that in his head while Danny's saying, I can't look back, or saying, drink with them, eat with them. It's kind of interesting. Excuse me. Together, that if they can't, if they either one of them go back, if they don't just keep going forward, if he doesn't kill the boy, if she doesn't just keep going, they will. Yeah, if John were to look back, he might find the truth. Yeah, that's a good point.
Okay, I'll jump in.
Go ahead.
Okay, so when I was doing it, all I kept thinking about was Ned's dreams versus John's dreams, mostly. Then I thought about what Bran said to Rickon. He got angry because Rickon let the Freys into the Crypts of Winterfell, and he got very, very angry. Now, when you go back to Ned's fever dreams, or any of his dreams, really, he says that the stones of the old kings are always looking at him, and he constantly repeats lies, right? Like, he knows he's done something wrong. And then when you go to John's chapters in the book, he also has that same feeling of the stones shifting, like they weren't supposed to be there because they're not Starks, and they dishonored it somehow. So that's a point for your theory, and I fully believe that. As for the winged serpent or a snake, I forget, it's one of those two, being Rhaegar. Rhaegar's armor, aside from his armor, even going back as far as when he was, when Cersei was a child, I actually found it in Cersei's chapter, where she says 17 and new to knighthood. Rhaegar had worn black plaid over golden ringmail when he cantered onto the lists. Long red streamers of red and gold and orange silk had floated behind his helm like flames. So when I think about this winged serpent shooting out flames, because it doesn't make sense that when Summer sees this winged serpent passing by, why would the winged serpent shoot out flames when the flames are supposed to be coming from the castle itself due to the burning? Like, he says it passes over the hill, then shoots flames. So I believe that when you tie the two together, the shadow would probably be the armor or what he's associated with, and the flames are probably his house colors or what he would normally wear. So with your theory, it's awesome from that point of view.
Thank you. It was just tying together some things that didn't make sense to me. Winged serpent, but the fact that it's, you know, just sounded dragon to me. And I know there's people who believe that there's a dragon in Winterfell. I don't know. I can't say yes or no. I can't say yes or no to any theory because I don't know. I can say I can agree or disagree, but I can't say yes, that's right, or no, that's wrong. It's just something that kind of struck me when I read it the first time that it was the dragon. But then going back and trying and piecing things together, it just struck me that, you know, if the swords, the fact that they removed Brandon's sword, and the fact that taking the swords off can release the spirits, is that the swords on the old crypts are iron. The sword on Rickard's tomb and the sword on Brandon's tomb and the one they had there for Ned were steel, which is alloy, so it's okay. It has an iron alloy in it, so it's the same thing, but they're not solid iron like the others on the older crypts are. Have a different theory for that anyway. As far as the vengeful spirits go, if it was the Long Night, some of those old ones are from as far back as the Long Night, then one of the things they could have been afraid of is not so much the spirits of their ancestors coming back, but them coming back as whites, having fought in the Long Night and died as, like, with White Walkers or whatever. They weren't so afraid of them coming back, their ancestors themselves, but them coming back as something other than themselves. But that's just a thought. So
also, didn't they say in the crypts that some of the oldest swords were rusted down to be in nothing? They were gone completely. Yeah, so
they're,
you know, it's
away.
More than just the swords that the kids took. There are other swords that have nothing there due to age. And the Crypts of Winterfell are huge. I mean, they go throughout all underneath the whole Winterfell complex. But it's my opinion, and I've said it before, that I believe that there's subterranean areas under the crypts and where the hot springs are. And I do believe that there possibly could be a dragon there. There's just too many mentions. It could be red herrings that they're throwing out there for us. But, you know, sometimes if they cry smoke, there's usually fire. So, but I believe that those tunnels underneath the crypts do go all the way across the wall and possibly to Bloodraven's cave or other caves of the children.
Yeah, I think those tunnels definitely go to the wall and probably too, because in Celtic mythology in Ireland, there are tunnels underneath tombs, especially Newgrange, I think, has a tomb of kings, and door of the tomb is the triple spirals we find all over the place with the red, blue, and green. So, and now it's the Massey sigil, these three Celtic spirals. So interesting about what you guys are talking about. It's really, really cool to think about the black armor, because that's the part that's always stuck with me when I think about Rhaegar and Jon. And I was looking at Jon's dream. And it's interesting how it's written. It says, "And then I find myself in front of the door to the crypts. The door to the crypts is made of ironwood. It's made of the black barked wood." So it's made of what I think is the opposite trees. It's the trees that the shade of the evening come from, that have blue leaves and they're black or marked. So if that door is the door to the crypts, watching for someone else to make sure that whatever it is that's in there, the Starks keep in there. It says after that is that it's black inside and I can see the steps spiraling down. Somehow I know I have to go down there, but I don't want to. I'm afraid of what might be waiting for me. Enter or down there, sitting on their thrones with stone wolves at their feet and iron swords across their laps. But it's not them I'm afraid of. I scream that I'm not a Stark, that this isn't my place, but it's no good. I have to go anyway. So I start down, feeling the walls as I descend with no torch to light the way. It gets darker and darker until I want to scream. I always wake. So black is right at the beginning of the dream down there. And of course it's black down there, but it's, think then, you know, we have Bran and Rickon in there, a lot of Theon in there with Lady Dustin, and they can see. John sees in his dream just black. This that I just want to say really quickly is that in, under the cave that the Yggdrasil tree sits in, the tree that seemingly is Bloodraven's cave, in the Tree of Life, down for just kind of like the tombs or the crypts. It spirals down and spirals down through old tombs until it gets to a black pool at the bottom in a cave. And that's really kind of, it's not rare in these myths to find the black pool at the bottom of the cave. So I just think that is different than Stark blood. We've got red blood in a place where blue blood people are buried. There's something, if he is in there, is a massive problem for whoever the Starks told they, whatever happened, the Starks had to have made a pact saying, we will watch whatever is down here and keep it here. I think that's why a Stark always has to be at Winterfell. I think they're responsible for not letting this thing out.
Yeah, I agree with that. It would have been nice, however, if they had passed that information down from generation to generation so that the last generations who were saying winter is coming don't even really know what it means. I mean, it's words, it's the house right. word, but they don't put the same that it originated as winter is coming actually meant something. And now they just say it like, you know, it's our house words, winter is coming. And they're looking at it as a season, not as a threat. And I agree with that. One of the theories that I saw while I was doing my research was on the fact that the Crypts of Winterfell, probably the only original structure left from Bran the Builder. The rest of the castle had been built in bits and pieces. That's why it wasn't leveled. And that the round towers that they have now indicate an early Andal construction, not a first men construction who built square. But that if he's the one who built the Crypts of Winterfell, could they have woven the same magic spells into the stones of the crypt that they did into the wall? And therefore it would become, when winter comes, it would be as much a bunker as anything else, a place, another place, as long as they don't let Bran in, it'd be another place for him to hide. It would be a magical place that would keep the White Walkers out. And that kind of fell in the theory with somebody who had a, can't remember who it was now. I should have wrote it down and I didn't. And I apologize for that. But his theory was they call it Winterfell because winter fell there, which I can kind of go with that and kind of not person. And I know that fells are another word for moors. And so it sits in the moors, and Winterfell could be winter moors. But then again, it could be the fact that winter fell there. And if it did, that they are holding something there. And that, but he called it the Great Other, but what thing it is, but they are hiding something there. Something is being held in there by magic.
I'd like to jump in for a minute. I would like to go back to the ironwood door. And you've got the iron on those graves, you know, at the the tombs of themselves. And you have ironwood door. Do you notice that it's not a weirwood door? And that, yeah, to me, tells me that goes along with that iron in that place, you know, keeping, it's a place that is a mysterious place, and there is something that's being kept there, and it may well be Rhaegar and his armor and harp and all that, and it, as well as other stuff, because, you know, all of this here stuff with the iron happened way before Rhaegar come along. So that tells me something there with it being an ironwood door and not a weirwood. A weirwood door would invite the others in to my way of thinking. And it goes back to my one I did on the Green Seers the White Walkers having Green Seers. You know, if they can hook to ice or to a weirwood connection, they would want another wood that they are not connected with. And I suppose ironwood may be that kind of wood. Just a thought.
How I see it.
Going on what Ashley was saying about the fact that putting Rhaegar there may be one of the things that putting a non-Stark in there, they would have broken a rule. And it may have been a you know, one of the things that has to do with this. I can't talk tonight, sorry. Has to do with this pact is that maybe, you know, maybe Ned didn't realize that, but putting Rhaegar in there was, they had a rule, and by putting somebody in there that was not a Stark, they broke that rule.
Yeah, they broke that rule in a few different, well, Ned broke the rule in a few different ways. Too, and Brandon. Yeah, I mean, an interesting thought, it really is, because it could have upset the balance of things. It really could.
And Ned wasn't bloodline. the first person to build a statue I didn't know that till I was doing my research. He wasn't the first person who built a statue.
No, he wasn't.
Baron Stark built one for his son, Artus the Implacable, and he wasn't a lord or anything. He just statue, so he built it. But Ned wasn't the first, but he was. And I always wondered that, because it says because he loved them so, and it just like a real, you know, tradition kind of guy, and this was a break from tradition, and it just didn't seem, you know, he was always so honorable and always stuck with tradition so closely, and this just seemed out of character. But it may have been that it was a matter of love. It may well have been. It just seemed kind of out of character for him to do something against always did things.
I'd like to make a point quickly for Lyanna properly being buried where she is. Just for a second. If Ned or Benjen obviously went to the wall, so he wouldn't want the throne. Ned wasn't married. We don't know if he technically wanted the throne at all. It could have instantly went to Lyanna if Ned, like Aemon, right, like from Castle Black, didn't want it, if you get what I'm saying. So it could be possible that it went Brandon, Lyanna, then Ned took it because Benjen was already at the wall or didn't want any part of it at all, and he was the last one left of his line and he had to take it. I'm just saying that it depends on the situation, right? We don't really know much on that subject at all. Because Ned constantly doesn't think about the past. So I'm just trying to play devil out of a kit for a second.
It's possible.
And Ned does talk about his lies that he's had to, you know, he's told through the years and everything. I think there's still more of a mystery to Ned Stark than anybody ever really thought.
I agree, Nan, completely. We know the half of who Ned Stark really was, secrets he was carrying around.
One of the things, it's kind of off topic, but one of the things that struck me, I was going back and watching something that struck me as kind of odd. I didn't pay any attention to it when I saw it the first time. It wasn't until after, later, I saw the Tower of Joy thing, then it went back to it. And that's when Jaime confronts Ned and they're fighting and the guy stabs him in the leg and then Jaime rides away and leaves him there. But when that happened at the Tower of Joy and Hal and Reed stabbed Arthur Dayne in the back, instead of leaving him there, Ned went ahead and killed him. In retrospect, who was the more honorable there? Was it Jaime or was it Ned? And that's just kind of an odd situation to me. And I don't understand why he had to go ahead and kill him. I mean, he was down, he was wounded, he was not going to get back up. So why did he have to go ahead and kill him, and with his own sword to boot? I love Ned, but it just seemed to me that in the comparing that to what Jaime didn't go ahead and kill him because it wouldn't have been honorable. And it just seemed like an odd juxtaposition to me.
I'll jump in really quick. I didn't like the way they did that in the show, and I don't know if it's going to be like that in the books, but to me is that, you know, I didn't like them kind of implying that had, you know, pretty much stabbed him in the back. I didn't like that, but maybe that's what happened. Who knows what happened? But I do think what I got out of it, Ned was kind of shocked and to Arthur because he was already mortally wounded. So I saw it as that he needed to be killed, and so he put him out of his misery.
Oh, that's possible. And I know, yeah, in the book, that's what happens a little. In King's Landing, what happened in the book between Jaime and Ned in King's Landing happened on the show. Oh. This is just basically a show thing, that it just seemed like an odd. In that particular case, Jaime actually had more honor than Ned did, and that's kind of weird.
Well, yeah, I see. I always say this. I think Jaime has a lot of honor. I think he just ends up in these situations that he, before Ned will ride up or walk up after, you know, something awful has happened. And just like with Aerys, and Jaime's sitting on the throne and here comes Ned. Ned always sees it after it's happened. Never quite know if Jaime's really done something good.
Right, and Jaime never stands up for himself. He never tells Ned. If he'd have told Ned half the stuff that actually happened, then Ned automatically judged, instead of, because he was a Lannister, because he was whatever, I don't know why, but he automatically judged Jaime.
Can I just jump in here for a sec? I got into a discussion with this a bit on Reddit. Who they watched the episode and they judged Ned immediately and said, "What a hypocrite for judging Jaime for stabbing the king in the back." But as I said, at that time, Ned may have thought that Lyanna was truly being kidnapped. So his first thought was to save his sister. He was young. And in the books, his sadness is in reflection, because he's older and he knows the truth now of what happened to Lyanna. She chose to go with Rhaegar, but at the time he may not have known that. And he probably thought, how could this honourable King's Guard like Sir Arthur Dayne take part in something as awful as kidnapping his sister and having Rhaegar rape her? He may have actually thought at that time that that was what was happening. So when he got to the Tower of Joy, he asked them, he gives them several times to get out of it, why weren't you at the Trident? Where your prince was, and why weren't you here and there? And like the Mad King is dead, it's kind of like, why weren't you protecting the royal family, which you were supposed to do instead of being here? So to me, it's a time where Bran is seeing things in real time when Ned is young, and his first thought is save his sister. And whereas in the books, when Ned's thinking back and dreaming of the Tower of Joy, he's got a sadness with him because he's reflecting back and he knows the truth of it. But at the time, he didn't. So what you're seeing is, and also the Krannic men have got a reputation of being like guerrilla warfare. That's how they fight. So stabbing someone in the back is perfectly natural for them because they're small men. There's no way that Hale and Reed is ever going to get and win a fight with Sir Arthur Dayne, and he was just out there to save his friend. So he did save Ned's life. But in war, things don't go to plan. People die in horrible ways, and backstabbing can happen because you're just out there to save your friend and it's a chaotic situation. But I think Ned gave Arthur Dayne several opportunities to speak the truth. And one of the things that's aggravating about Martin is no one ever does come out and speak. I wish they were all Australian, because we'd all speak our minds and we'd all know why. Instead, he constantly leaves it open. So that's my point, in that in the books and the show, it's kind of different. You get an older Ned reflecting back. He knows the truth, and it saddens him that he killed Arthur Dayne. A younger Ned is fretful. He's worried. He wants his sister safe.
Okay. you can go, old man.
No, I was just going to say that I agree that, you know, the difference in a young person and their frame of mind is certainly different at an older age. And I can say that from experience.
Okay, as for the Tower of Joy. I think Ned knew the instant he fucking walked up what he was getting into. I don't think you can not know. You're talking about you have three Kingsguard in front of you. How do you not know? Like, it's a no-brainer to me. Like, he knew. And as he's in, like, when his fever dream takes place in the Red Keep, for me, he tells John that he'll talk about his mother, both in the show and in the book, when John is going to the Wall. So he knows. He just doesn't want to tell him. He's lying to him to save his life. As for the Howland Reed stabbing of Sir Arthur Dayne in the Jaime Ned correlation, I think it was justified. Not only for all the guerrilla warfare and Ned was going to die, like the possibilities are endless in that situation. Also, you're talking about it's a battle, like you should be prepared, especially if it's Sir Arthur Dayne, you have the best, supposedly the best sword in the whole entire world. You should expect to be fighting two people instantly. But it's not so much what that it was dishonorable, like the if Howland killed Sir Arthur Dayne, it's the fact of the sword, which brings me to my point that Ned brought Dawn back to the Danes, where it rightfully belongs until a claimant can be made upon it, where Tywin took the blade and then broke it down for his own family's use. That's more dishonorable to me than you killing me from the back. You're talking about it's a family sword, it has a legacy, and it shouldn't be tampered with at all. And depending on what theory you believe, whether Dawn's Lightbringer or the two swords are Lightbringer and all that mumbo jumbo, it's still the family sword at the end of the day, right? Like, imagine if someone took something of that belonged to your family. Like, that's what's dishonorable about that whole situation. I'm done.
I agree with that. That what Tywin did was just, that was, but my other question in that is, I want to know how Ned knew where to go. I mean, how did he know to go to the Tower of Joy? I mean, this is like in the middle of nowhere. How did he know that that's where he should go? I mean, would the first place you would look for your sister would be in that bothers me too. Look for your sister would be in the backyard of the prince's wife's. I don't know. That's kind of weird. But it just always wondered how he knew that that's where he should go to find her.
On the location, can I go or does anyone else? Okay, I'll just go. When I think about the taking of King's Landing, when Tywin came in and Ned and Robert and Jaime on the throne and all that, Varys was working for Aegon, or Aerys, sorry. So it makes sense that Varys would know, being that he was still the master of whispers and stuff like that. So it's just a safe bet. But if in the show and the books, there is a possibility that Petyr might have known. So I can see it happening on why. As for the actual location, I would have expected it to be like Summerhall or someplace that you wouldn't instantly think of going, like a ruined castle, right? So.
Yeah, going back to the how did Ned know, another question I have is how did Rhaegar know where Lyanna was when he supposedly went to kidnap her, which makes me think it was a rendezvous. If it's a rendezvous, there has to be a go-between. I know people bring up Littlefinger, but to me he wasn't in power then, Varys was, and I think Littlefinger was too young. I may be wrong there, but I think Littlefinger was too young, didn't have the power to intervene. And I was just wondering how did Rhaegar know where to where Lyanna was, and it's true what Faye said. How did Ned know where Lyanna was when she was kidnapped? How did Ned know to go to Dorne? Who told him? So are they going to be revealed in the books, or is this kind of something that where Martin has dropped the ball a bit? I just wondered.
Marie, go ahead.
I haven't had a chance to talk. Go ahead.
I was just going to say that goes back to as far as Rhaegar knowing where to get Lyanna. You know, I did that video on Rhaegar's search for wife number two. And to my way of thinking, that whole setup at Harrenhal was not only to talk about his father and the changes in the realm, but it was for him to search for wife number two. And when he placed those blue flowers in Lyanna's lap, it was a signal to his wife, which her being her and it being the time and a Targaryen and Dornish, I think she would have agreed, and that was his signal that's who he had picked for his second wife, or to have the third head of the dragon.
Mm-hmm. I like that. I wanted to say something about the location too, and how did they know? Did Rhaegar know? And why was it in the Tower of Joy instead of, say, at Summerhall or something? But if you look at the map, I was just looking at it the other day, kind of trying to figure out where all these things are placed in relation to each other. Griffin's Roost is right there. It's almost like a Bermuda Triangle of Summerhall, Roost, Tower of Joy, and White Walls, where Aegon was born. Was born at Summerhall, and Jon was born at the Tower of Joy. I wonder if Jon Cunnington might have something to do with this, because, you know, Griffin's Roost is right there. Even if he didn't, I think maybe that he was, that, you know, Lyanna was taken to Dorne, well, to the Tower of Joy in Elia's country of Dorne. Elia knew that this was something Rhaegar was obsessed with since before he met her, long before he met her, when he was a child. He, you know, some sort of agreement with her. Like you said, Nan, when at the tourney of Harrenhal, he gave Lyanna, he crowned her, it seems like that was not so awful to do in front of Elia. Maybe everybody else didn't know that. I think all the smiles died for a different reason than that. I think all the smiles died because two different bloodlines of kings were going to come together. The Pact of Ice and Fire was going to be fulfilled, but no one knows that anymore. Everyone forgot. So now it just looks like these two can't marry. These two can't be together. They're two different, you know, the Kings of Winter and the Kings in the South. They're not the same thing. We can't mix them. That is one thing. The other thing is that Tower of Joy, Lancelot had a tower that was guard. And Rhaegar very much seem like they have to do with Uther Pendragon, Arthur Dayne, Lancelot, all of King Arthur, the whole thing is there. It's all there. So it sort of makes me think about maybe that's why he took him there. That was his best friend's place. It was a place of joy. It was supposed to be a place of joy. Maybe that's where he took her in a good way. Got misconstrued. And took off and went Rhaegar at King's Landing. I don't know where it went wrong, but let me think of Lancelot. Thanks, Steph.
I think it went wrong with Brandon. I think he was on his way once blood play. I don't know. Depends on who told him, who gave him the news. My personal opinion is that relationship. Don't know what Rickard knew and what he did not know. I don't think he went to King's Landing to get his daughter back. I think he went to King's Landing to get his hot-headed son and protect him from the Mad King, which didn't turn out well. But it depends on how the news was given to him and who gave him the news. Someone told him specifically that she was kidnapped. Or if he just made that assumption, it's not really clear as to news, yes. But who gave him the news and how it was given, something else entirely. As far as knowing, I agree with what Steffi said. I think Varys is a good choice for that, for telling him. I never thought about it, and he would have been a good choice for telling Ned where to go and to find his sister. I agree. When he came there, he had to know. With three Kingsguards there, he had to know. There's just no way he wouldn't know that there was something in that tower, and besides his sister. But the other question I always had was back to the other thing about Rhaegar kidnapped Lyanna or joined or whatever. It's not so much how he knew where she was, but what the heck was she doing there? I mean, it had been almost a year since the tourney was over. What was she doing wandering around Harrenhal, around the area of Harrenhal, unless she was there for a reason, and think of would be to meet Rhaegar.
If I may, you got to think that Brandon was on his way down there to marry Catelyn. So she possibly could have been on her way down there earlier to stay with Cat until the wedding. And at that point, and I'm sure that if there was some spooning going on at the tourney, then that there may have been some communication since then between the two in that year. I'm sure there possibly was. I really don't think from what Barristan Selmy and everybody else says about Rhaegar that he would have just kidnapped her. But then again, he's a Targaryen too, so that just goes for one thing. Ladies?
I'll jump in. When it comes to Brandon, I always think about what Lady Dustin was talking about to Theon and the Southern ambitions, or the Northern ambitions, excuse me. And how Brandon might have been left out of the dark, which is a point to you, Faye, for in your video, you do address this issue. And I believe maybe Rickard was just trying to off his kids throughout the realm and to overtake power. But this all goes back to, what's that stupid tourney called? The Night of the Laughing
Tourney.
Yeah. That I think
Harrenhal.
And how maybe when this was addressed, like of possibly Rhaegar overthrowing Aerys, he might have thought it a good idea. If Rhaegar did address the lords that were present at this time, it would have been Brandon involved as well. So it doesn't make sense for Brandon to get mad at Rhaegar and to go and demand more when Rhaegar would have told him for him being the eldest in the family. So for me, Rickard should have been present at the tourney of Harrenhal, but I believe there was a Northern ambition and maybe Brandon was left out due to him already being betrothed to Kat. So yeah, that's just my take on it. That may be how things got muttered up in the process. But even if that was true, you think the Maester would have made someone else aware of Lyanna's whereabouts, which could also be a reason why Ned was able to find her at the Tower of Joy, because the Maester knew about it and he served whatever Stark was the Lord at the time, because Brandon said, Rickard said, bam, Ned would know. He would have to tell him. There would be no choice in the matter. But yeah, it's just it.
I wanted to go in there and address the Maesters and the conspiracy. You know, that pact of ice and fire, way back in the conquest of Aegon's conquest, and it has not been fulfilled. And it seems to me that it, you know, that the Maesters could possibly have had some influence on not fulfilling that pact, if there is some type of conspiracy. But yeah, I think that they did not want the houses of Stark and Targaryen to mix. I think there was a thing going around, a certain group of people that were very much trying to keep hold of their own power, probably.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I'm muted. No, I'm not. Can I say something real quick? There's something that I want to say about Rhaegar's harp and the mythology behind probably what's behind this harp. The king of the Tuatha De Danann, who was called Dagda, harp that was given to him by it was pure gold and it had silver strings, and nobody else could play it. And people actually, somebody did steal the harp while they were at battle, and it's kind of like Thor's hammer. He can call it back to him whenever he wants to. And the harp also controls the seasons. I'm wondering if Rhaegar's songs, you know, do with the seasons, because this king of the Tuatha De Danann, who, you know, the forest of this story, seems like it would be something that he could play and bring destruction with. And I don't see Rhaegar bringing much destruction. These songs could entrance people. They could entrance a whole battlefield. So I think Rhaegar had a little bit of through that harp, maybe, than we know so far. So the other thing I wanted to say was about Rhaegar and the tourney of Harrenhal, was that it seems to me like you were just talking, Faye, about Jaime and Ned, and Jaime not killing Ned, seeming to have a little more honor in that situation. The same kind of situation happened in the throne room, where left Jaime there with Aerys. He put his hand on her and he said, things will be very different when I come back. And it makes me wonder if they hadn't have already happened, but Aerys wouldn't leave. Or he didn't know and they were going to do it after. They were going to this after the Trident. Why would Rhaegar ever think he'd lose? You know, he would go into that thinking he was gonna die. He went into that thinking he was gonna win and that he was gonna be king and what great things he was gonna do after that. And so that makes me think that he has a little bit of more of a brotherhood with Jaime And that's why I think Jamie has a little bit more honor than we think. And that a lot of plans that he talked to a lot of people about. And then they all died really then, you know? And things got really sad.
I agree. I think that Rhaegar telling Jaime that, and it's like he knew things would be different, and he excuse me, I don't think his plans, and I think he'd already put those plans in motion. I also definitely believe that Harrenhal was the tourney at Harrenhal was his idea, that they were the ones, because everybody knew that they couldn't afford the purses that were being paid. That money had to come from somewhere, and I think it came from the Targaryen, it came from Rhaegar, to make the purses big enough to draw everybody there. I think the plans were already in motion. He already had plans. I think, you know, it was obvious to anybody, I think, that excuse me, that that Aerys was just not, that there was just no way that he could continue to rule. I think that I think the Mad King showing up was another one of those underhanded things. He would never have gone. He never went out. He never would have gone if he hadn't been coerced to go, to telling him that something was going on. There was some other strings being pulled in the background to go against what Rhaegar had planned.
I would say that would be Varys. You know, Varys is very much about, I think he liked the way Aerys was running through the realm, and if Rhaegar took over, no, I just don't know. Because Varys is a very strange person, and I think he still think he has ties to the Blackfyres, and I think even way back then he may have been plotting a return of the Blackfyre.
Just going back to the tourney of Harrenhal, what's always interested me was the Children of the Forest input, because you've got Helen Reed at the God's Eye, and he's this is a tourney where people meet and they're looking for wives, or they're looking for a step up. Helen can't fight. Helen's not rich. Helen has got no chance of gaining a high wife because the Crown of Magna looked down upon. So because there's that connection to the Children of the Forest, I still believe that Blood Raven is also in connection with Rhaegar. I don't believe that he's only talking to the Mad King, because Rhaegar was very much a man for prophecy, and I just think that Blood Raven contacted Rhaegar, and all this tourney of Harrenhal was meant to happen, that Lyanna, as Nan said, was meant to meet Rhaegar. I believe the Children in the Forest are involved in this, and it's connected also to Blood Raven. It's a huge big plan to join the pact of the Song of Ice and Fire, which was not kept. And I think Blood Raven knew that it needed to be kept, and this all came about to make Jon Snow, so that Rhaegar and Lyanna would have Jon Snow, and that balances Ice and Fire, which should have been done ages ago. So you can't disregard Helen Reed's input and the Children of the Forest and Blood Raven. And as for Varys, I think Varys backed the Targaryens. I don't know how old Aegon was back then. But I've always wondered, do we underestimate also Elia Martell? Because I go back to the War of the Roses and Elizabeth Woodville, and there's always been this mystery that Elizabeth Woodville swapped a son so that the two princes, there was only one prince in the tower and a pretender. And when they died, the pretender died, and the Perkin Warbeck was, as he was known later, disappeared and came back in history to haunt Henry Tudor, eventually lost his life. But I'm thinking, like, would Varys have swapped the baby with Elia's permission? Is that going to be the big secret that's going to shock everyone? I second thought that because Aegon was dismissed from the show. And if that's going to be a big thing, then surely it should have been increased unless George wanted it specifically kept for the books and not the show. So I just wondered about that too. Finished. Sorry. Okay, I'll not mute. Does anybody else want to say something?
Sorry to sit here with dead air. I thought I was muted, but I guess I'm not. For some reason, all I keep thinking about is Torrhen Stark and the Pact of Ice and Fire. I feel like it's got something to do with Torrhen Stark and the fact that the Pact of Ice and Fire wasn't fulfilled because of a Valerion. Not really even a Targaryen. It was Jaehaerys Valerion. So it's like they prevented it from happening. They wanted to. They didn't want the two bloodlines to mix. All I can think of is the King who knelt. Steffi, I can tell that this is killing you. Go
ahead. It is. Right now, like, I'm freaking out because I was just about to say that right before you went, and I was just like, damn it. Yeah, I was thinking about that, and all I kept thinking about is maybe, okay, due to the red grass field and it being burnt and everything like that, I was thinking maybe Torrhen Stark knelt because he didn't want the crypts to be burnt. If it came to a battle or a siege of any kind, like the first keep where the crypt was. And I find it really weird that also, I think it's Brandon Snow, came and said, like, I'll assassinate them for you if you want, right? He was a bastard brother. So I find it weird, the parallels on that, where, like, it may be tied into the others. Because the monster is Brandon, right? Cold Hands is a Brandon, correct? Right? I think we can all agree, like, I am your monster, Bran, right? So, just, like, mind blown, like, good jubes right now.
That's so cool. I love it. I love it because I was thinking about the monster, too.
Yeah, that's that all goes back. A lot of that goes back to that Pact of Ice and Fire, and it's something I think that even the Children of the Forest realized that this, you know, in farming, you know, it's called animal husbandry, and in the Green Seer's vision and way of looking at things. That could have been just their way of out the world of magic with the ice and the fire.
That it reactivated the magic? Is that what you said?
No, hon, I think that they knew that they had to get these two races together in order to balance out the destruction they had caused by the White Walkers. Ice melt, you know, fire melts ice, and ice, when it melts, turns into water, which puts out fire. And also that... They're the two magical groups, families, the most magical of the lands of Westeros. And, you know, you've definitely got some magic with Starks in that they have the green sight, they have warging abilities, they have green seers in their bloodline, and you have also the same kind of magic, but in a fire magic on the Targaryen side, in that they have the dragon dreams, they have prophecies, they have basically warg into the dragons, you might as well say, or they ride, their minds are connected with their dragons, the same way, in a way, the same as the warging is in the north. Does that make sense?
Right. So you're just talking about merging the magical lines together, right? If I'm correct. Is that the point you're...
Yeah, and I think that that's why they... one of the reasons why they... Bloodraven definitely maneuvered all of this, in my vision. I mean, you can see all the way back to Aegon and Summerhall. I wouldn't doubt him having a hand in Summerhall. And as far as that goes, yeah, I think that these were the two. There was their way of trying to make up or to cure the illness that is the White Walkers.
I'm trying to figure out because the red and the green, the red and the blue, of course, the biggest deal throughout this whole story. It's, I was just looking at some Celtic mythology this morning, and I was looking at, I'm going to do a video on it, but I was looking at a god named, I hope I don't butcher this word, Cernumnus, and he's the green man. It's the man in the tree. Basically, it's like, if you know the story Gawain and the Green Knight, it's kind of that, but he's the man in the tree. He's the man who sits in the tree, watches the seasons pass by. He's a skin changer. They call him a shapeshifter, but thing in these books. So, what was interesting to me about him was that one thing when Catelyn Stark in the very beginning of A Game of Thrones. When she sits down next to Ned and he's cleaning ice off in the after Garrett, she looks in the pond. No, I'm sorry, it's not there. It's that Eerie. He looks up and she sees the moon, and then she looks into a pond and she sees the horned god. She says it a couple different times. She says she sees the horned moon and then she sees the horned god. And the horned god, kind of like to herald the new god coming into being. And she sees it at the Eerie a lot. And the Eerie is was the first word used for Ireland. So, and they also use the word Ari too, which, and they say a few things about that have to do with the tie right into Aria, just in Celtic mythology itself. It's a lot of it is about the primalness, the primal mossy decomposing sort of the godswood veil, the same in these old northern places, like the primordialness of the earth. And Catelyn was talking about feels like this Godwood is so freaky to her because she doesn't understand it, because she grew up in River Run, where by the Red Fork, where were redwood trees that grew, flowers blooming and birds singing. That to me says red, red, red everywhere. Was brought into Winterfell for her, that point that has something in it, in the sept, seven-sided obelisk, really, alive with light. Very interesting that that's in the sept. Just talking about dawn makes me wonder if that might not be dawn. I mean, wouldn't that be the most to hide it? If it did make its way to Winterfell, maybe with Ashara or with Ned. Why wouldn't that be the perfect place to hide it, is in the sept, where no one would ever think to look for it. Not in the crypts at all. Kind of leaning to the fact that John might be the next Sword of the Morning.
Okay, can I go next? I'm going to change this subject a little bit here, because one thing that came up to me with in the Swords video too is, why does Ned feel so much guilt? I mean, it's kind of like he's carrying the weight of the world on his shoulders. And back in those days, women, it was 50-50 for women when they had childbirth, whether they'd come through it or not. They risked their lives every time they gave birth. So I always wondered, what is this heavy guilt that Ned carries with him? And I tend to think, because he's such an honourable man, it's because he didn't keep faith with or told lies. But what lies were they? And I'm thinking, like, I can't imagine that Lyanna, I think, knew about the prophecies. She was probably with Rhaegar on the prophecies. And I can't believe that she would want Jon hidden away forever. So I'm just wondering, did she want Jon to eventually find out who he was? Because she and Rhaegar may have known what was coming, like the real war that is going to happen. And Ned, for his own reasons, allows Jon to go to the war. Maybe psychologically there is this part of him that doesn't like the Targaryens, because they did kill his father and brother in a horrible manner. And I'm thinking, because he's always kind of watching Jon in an odd kind of way. If you look at him, he's watching Jon in a thoughtful way. He's watching Jon in a different way. And I'm just wondering, is he looking for signs of madness in Jon, like Cersei says, when you flip a coin, never a Targaryen is born? And was there a kind of, because when you look at Ned in different chapters, you get a kind of different perception of him. In his own POV, he's this honourable, wonderful guy. Read Theon's and you find out it's actually him and Kat are a little bit cold, distant. They never kind of included him. They always made sure that he was on the outside looking in, and Kat is even worse to Jon. And Ned allows it. He never corrects Kat in her attitude to Jon, which I think is wrong. He should have, especially knowing of Jon's true birth. So I'm kind of wondering, what is this lie? And then Bran has that dream where he sees Ned in the crypts again, and he said, and he was sad, and it was something about Jon. So I'm thinking, what is the guilt or the lie that Ned's carrying? And Sword, because you came up with it, have you got any ideas about that?
I think it's simply that he knows who Jon's mother is, and he's never told him. And now he can't tell him. And as far as Catelyn's concerned, I had a problem with that too, the way she treated Jon and the fact that, you know, she's his wife, he should have told her. But on the other side of that, I think that was just another form of his protection. If she had treated, even Jaime said that when she was talking to him when he was held captive, and he said, when Ned brought that home, you treated him like one of your own, didn't you? Oh no, not you, not Catelyn Stark. If she'd have known Jon true parenting, she would have treated him differently, and Ned not telling her, she treated him exactly the way people would have expected her to treat him And I think it was a way to hide, to keep his identity hidden, because Catelyn would have treated him differently. And if people saw her treating him differently, they would have thought something was up. And I think that's the main reason he didn't tell her, because it bothered me at first too. But I think actually my sister is the one who pointed that out to me. She said, you know, if she'd have treated him differently, people would have noticed. And the fact that he brought this child home, that was her pet peeve. Not that bastard, but that he brought him home with him instead of, you know, like everybody else, hiding him away or keeping him with, leaving him with his mother or with his other family or whatever. But the fact that he brought him home, that was her main pet peeve, was that he brought him home where people could see. And but she would have treated him differently, and that would have shown.
I'll jump in. When it comes to Marie picking out how Ned is watching John, I also find to prove your point that he goes to the Night's Watch, which is also a place of degenerates and highborns. So it's kind of a toss of a coin on who the Night's Watch gets. Are they going to get a worthy knight, or are they going to get some person who murdered someone? They don't really know, right? So, and you were talking about a dream. Bran tells Maester Luwin of his dream, and then Ned is sad about John. That's what the dream is. But he does mention it, but he can't remember it. And it's at the very beginning. So it might be because he hasn't tapped into his third eye quite as much yet. But on the point of Winterfell and it burning, another point for your video, Faye, is Winterfell has burnt before. The Red Kings burnt it down twice, and that's just of what we know. It was also struck down by lightning. Supposedly, that's the rumor of the broken tower. So it's weird that all this stuff is happening, all right? Like, Bran sees this winged snake, but it's the events have already happened. Now, that being said, like you, I did do a little research into it. And people said it could have been him seeing a past vision without realizing it. But when you go back and you look at where Summer was and where he later was, he says that he can't see anything, or he can't see how Winterfell is being burnt from where Summer was when viewing the burning of Winterfell. So I just like to mention that. So another point for you.
It's a great video. I wanted to make a point that now it has gone out of my head, but I'm hoping it's going to come back. Was that when Ned brought John home in the first place, Catelyn's maids were talking about Ashara Dane and the fact that they would, or gossiping about Ashara Dane and Ned and all of that. And that was, Catelyn says that Ned ever yelled, that he ever raised his voice in anger. And he ordered them all stop talking about John, not Ashara, but John. So that to me is kind of another thing Ned might be, is why would he say John when they're talking about Ashara? Oh, I just think that the Danes have so much to do with this that we haven't yet found. And I think that might answer a few of our questions about how people knew where people were and all of that. Wanted to say about Rhaegar's harp really quick is that it can also play the songs of the past, present, and future.
I don't know that that is attributed to Rhaegar's harp as it is in Celtic mythology, but a sense if it was. Somebody else go.
I'll jump in right quick. Go ahead, Faye. Go ahead.
No, that's okay. I was just going to say that I thought the thing about Rhaegar's harp, I find it fascinating. There's a lot of mythology there. There's a lot of the reason it's special is I think important because it, I think it's just, I find it, I can't talk tonight for some reason. I don't know why. I find it fascinating though. The Rhaegar's harp and the fact that, the fact that he would go to Summerhall and spend the night there and play. And he always came back with a song. And it's, there's just more to that. There's something underlying there. I agree. It's interesting.
I find it very interesting too. I would like to go back to the Catelyn part. Even when Rob was sending terms to Cersei and them and King's Landing, Catelyn thinks to herself then that Ned was right. He said that his place was in the north and that he should never have, she should never have let him ask him to come. She was the one that was pushing Ned south. And as far as Ned not telling her what was going on, that if he had told her, she would have had different reactions, yes, of course, to Jon Snow. She would have treated him better in some respects, which is hypocritical in itself. But if she had known he was Rhaegar's son, she might have pushed Ned to go back and, you know, and she always worried about Rob. John take Rob's place. But if she knew that he was actually a king, a prince, instead of a lord, you know, you never know what she would have thought. So I don't think he trusted her. And I think that that's why he didn't tell her.
I completely agree, Nan. I think, you know, what I was saying about the Godswood at River Run is she made a big point of saying that she was never comfortable in the north. You know, she was of the south. So, you know, I mean, even though they made the marriage alliance have the Tullys and the Starks together, the Tullys are still southern, very northern, and so maybe he didn't trust her. Reason not to. I don't know that Catelyn would have accepted John. I think she might have, I don't know, I wouldn't have trusted her with that information.
I'll go next. I kind of think the Tullys are unstable Mables and unsteady Eddies. So maybe Ned just didn't trust the Tullys. And they also had kind of like a very ambitious family. But I thank you, Sword, for your video. I thought it was really interesting. You came up with some really good thoughts there. And it's an interesting theory that I had not heard before. So I really thank you for that. But I think it's time to move on to Ashley's vid on John and Ghost to let people understand. Ashley did this vid in season six. It's about the relationship between John and Ghost in season six. I found it really interesting. Ashley, would you like to describe what the vid is about and how you came about these ideas? Because I picked up some really good points in my notes here.
Yeah, thank you, Marie. I did that video so long ago, I had to watch it again today. And I gotta redo it. It's really long and I ramble. But anyway, what I was is that there's a Latin word for snow. And when you break the word down, the etymology of the word, it means that the gods are sending, really, that they're giving something to humans. Of what the word mean, the word itself for snow, I think it's, I can't remember the word, but I can't remember, but it also said that wolf can be a white wolf is always more loyal, more, yes, shaleg was the word. Thank you. That was the word, and it has many meanings about loyalty and also gods and men. Giving, you know, it's almost like Prometheus giving fire. It's kind of like the same thing. That with Ghost also being a white wolf, that he did the spirit of someone else inside of him. His name being Ghost even makes that solidified. I don't know that he's actually carrying someone else's spirit in him, like a real, you know, like Rhaegar or Lyanna or someone, but it would kind of make a little bit of sense if someone's consciousness were in Ghost. Make such different decisions. You pointed this out, Marie, and it was brilliant. When Ghost is not around John, he makes very different decisions than he does when Ghost is there. Oh. Who knows if there's astral projection going on here? I think there's a little bit of, you know, consciousness shifting. And I wonder if, you know, the thing I was getting at with the white wolf is mainly Native American beliefs that those are the shamans. Those are carriers of knowledge. So if anyone remembers, it's Ghost. And I think that there's a lot to be learned from Ghost. If maybe John would go in to Ghost a little bit more, learned. Makes John very special. Wolf, just like Varamyr Sixskins said, that is the life of a king.
Yeah, what I found interesting too was like the word snow. I think it's in the books and the show, in that Ygritte says all snow means evil in the wildling culture, which I thought was odd because surely Ned would be aware, although I suppose being a bastard he's going to be called Snow. But I thought surely Ned would be aware of that. And also the title, A Song of Ice and Fire. Ice is made of water, while fire is another element, and both can wipe each other out. Whereas in John, you have the elements combining. John is both ice and fire, so he's kind of like what I've said all along. The what should we call it? I'm losing my thought. Senior moment. He's kind of like the fulfillment of the ice and fire. He's the balance. That's what I was looking for. He's the balance, because he's both like Night King is ice and the others are ice, and Danny is fire. So there's an imbalance to me when they both come into it, whereas John is the balance. So I do think John is important. And also there's some symbolism of water. Got me with that symbolism of water. And I thought water symbolizes purity. It is used in the church as a cleansing of past sins and a rebirth. To a new life, which washes away sins. There's also a symbolic gesture that one is born anew. It also is an affirmation of life, because water is life-giving. If we don't have water, we die. And it's also a part of who we are. There's water in our body. When you stab us, we bleed both blood and water. So to me, it's and Serio Farrell says the same thing to Arya. when you step a man, water comes out. So I just found the element of water really interesting. And there's also the death element to it. So it's both life and kind of death, the opposite of each other. And I just really clued onto that word. That really got me. And I just loved it. And so I just come up with all these things just on that little one word that you brought in with the water symbolism. Thank you for that.
Thank you so much. The way I see it is that there's the elements here, you know? And so when the water comes down, ice, there, it's water is the element, not ice, water. I remember this is what I said in the video, that water is coming from the heavens and hitting the earth, which are two different. So once those two are combined, that brings the water and the earth together. The fire and air is brought together in, so, you know, that to me, that's what makes John the Holy Grail, right? Wall.
Yeah, and also, like, you also brought up a point too, like the men in Westeros today have forgotten the past. And to me, that means to me that they're doomed to repeat it, which I think is happening. Because the wall was built there for a reason. Winterfell has its name for a reason. But if you were to ask Ned or the, well, not Ned, but the people that are present now, they wouldn't be able to tell you what the names mean. They've forgotten what they're about. And they've forgotten their mission. Like you can see that in the way the Night's Watch is behaving. They've lost their mission. There's anarchy ruling, actually, at the Night's Watch. They've killed two Lord Commanders. And at Winterfell, that name has a reason. And I think even the Starks have forgotten why it's said. So I'm kind of thinking that they're doomed to repeat it because they've not learnt the lessons of their own land. The children of the forest remember better than what the men have. The stories have not passed down as it should have been. And they've forgotten their original mission, to my mind.
Yeah, you know, you just reminded me of something that's really interesting, that someone left a comment under that video when I did it, and they said, you need to know the meaning of the word Winterfell, old English meaning of the word. It's actually, I think, it's really difficult to even find it, but it is the old English word for Winterfell. It's Winterfelled. In those times, they didn't even count the winter months as months. They just said it was darkness. They left off in like October, Hain, at the end of October on Halloween, the festival of Samhain, through the winter, and they didn't start counting months again until. So all those months were Winterfell. Not that that's why it's named Winterfell. I think it's one of the reasons why it's named that. But I also think things have fallen there. Had Lady Mythos and I came up with a theory that it was angels who had fallen there during the war in heaven. And that Winterfell, because it has the wood with the black tree and the white tree, and the black barked, let's call it ironwood tree. Those are sort of like the black and white pillars of Solomon's and of really the Garden of Eden, if you want to look at it that way. Well, itself is almost like the garden. It's a safe place. It's a refuge. It's the first place that's really a safe and supposedly impenetrable. So, seeing that it is called Winterfell, and it took me a long time to wrap my mind around that. It has to do with the number 8. October is 8. So it's almost like that's the infinity of itself and things happening over and over again. Itself actually translates in Old English into octo, and because they October, but December, because they didn't recognize those months. They said the sun died. When the sun comes back, they started the months over again.
So I find that all fascinating. And also like the number 333. It's a holy number. I think everybody realizes that. And is used a lot in A Song of Ice and Fire. What I found fascinating too is that Martin himself has used this as his own kind of clue thing. He gives three clues in the books before he reveals what he's about, if you understand what I mean. So when you read, like reading up to the Red Wedding, you can see the clues and you can add them up, and it usually adds up to three, and then the big reveal happens. So to me, that also got me too, was the whole 333. And Martin uses also many sources from history, including myths and legends. I'm sure he's looked at Ragnarok and all, and the Celts, and also from real history. And John, as you said, is the hero, and his resurrection to me resembles Christ, but with one thing differing. Those who come back in Martin's books come back different and less of themselves, whereas Christ fulfilled his mission when in Mark kind of twists that on its head, and when the people would come back from the dead, they're actually less of themselves. And when they actually come back, I mean, Beric and John came back and they tell Melisandre, well, in the show, but not so much in the books, but in the show, and I'm still sure it'll happen in the books too, that they actually see nothing. There's nothing on the other side. So I found that quite interesting. But the whole thing that where Martin has turned it on its head is that they come back less of who they are. So you just got to wonder if John is going to die again, be brought back so many times. Is his bittersweet ending going to be that even though he's the hero of the story, which I believe he is, by the end of it, will we know who John is, and will John remember who he is?
I'd like to follow that train of thought. When I was hearing about, like, listening to your theory, I've listened to it like so many times, I had to re-listen to it today. But I kept thinking of Ned's fever dream of when Lyanna's like weeping blood, and that is like a foretelling of like a miracle or warning. And it makes sense with the whole religious aspect to me that John is going to be the hero. I found that very interesting. As for like the entire thing, I found it very fascinating, especially with the Winds of Winter release of Arianna, on how they find this pool. And then when you look at the pool in Winterfell and how the lady bathed in it before giving birth, it kind of marks that as also, I'm blanking out right now, but of a baptism.
Baptism.
Yeah, that's it. And I wonder if Lyanna did that since she was in Dorne at the time. And that's basically, And also this also mirrors the Ironborn rises, like what is dead never dies, but rises again harder and stronger. So yeah, I'm with you 100%. It's pretty good.
There you go again, Steffi. You're always reading my mind. I was just going to say something about the Ironborn too, because what I find very interesting, a couple streams ago, we were talking about Bran's eye color being blue. And I was looking at Celtic mythology and Irish, and basically the same thing happened. Of course, George has messed with it a little bit, but the same thing really did happen. The Tuatha De Danann landed on Ireland. They were a very supernatural race of people, children of the forest. Then the Formorians came. The Formorians were of seafaring people, and they were taller, blonde, and blue-eyed. The Malaysians came later. They were just called men. And I found this really interesting because I didn't know that the Formorians were seafarers. So what that tells me is that the Ironborn were there. I remember either. And what it says is that the Formorians made a deal with the Tuatha De Danann saying that they would go under the sea. Tuatha would, and they made the deal with the Malaysians, who are more like the first men. So the Formorians, though, and then do battle with the Tuatha De Danann. So it's like the coming in and raiding and all the Greyjoy rebellions. Every time they would come in and battle, they would take salt wives and they would mate. Some of them would stay behind and intermarry and intermingle. So their blood got mixed in. Blue eyes comes from them. And the blue eyes is another way to tell who has the blue bloodline and who has the red bloodline. Dragon bloodline and who has the blue ice bloodline. I don't know if it's so much ice, it's just the Formorian bloodline. It's kind of, George messed with it so that the Formorians were the first men and that the Malaysians were more like the, but it seems like it's messed up a little bit, but it's the same concept that the blue eyes have been bred in. It's not a very a blue-eyed child. It's harder to get a blue-eyed child than brown eyes or green eyes. It's a trait that has to come from both parents. So the blue, what I was thinking about is that fools and, you know, what we were talking about with people adapting to the darkness, just like the black pools and the white albino fish that Elia Martell was catching one in the Ariane chapter. And it's like Blood Raven. He's an albino. He's in the tree. He was born that way, but maybe he was born to go into the tree. I don't know. Way are becoming more to the darkness. The other thing I wanted to say is that now being kind of like a Jesus figure, I think he's a little bit more like a Mithras figure, who's the same. I mean, we've got a million god figures like Jesus, but Mithras was the one who came out of Persia, and he was a warrior god. Because of Davos worshiping the warrior things, it makes me feel like John is a little bit more like a Mithras than he is a... So I'll let somebody else talk.
I would like to go back to that part you were talking about, the ones under the sea. And you were saying that they were sent to remain and live under the sea. Am I correct, Ashley?
Yeah, so what I found that was so interesting is that in this thing I was reading about Celtic mythology, about the Formorians, they actually said, I'm reading it and it says, so the word Formor, in the etymology, looking at the etymology of the word, for... And then I-R-E means under the sea. Maybe when Patchface says under the sea, he's actually meaning literally under the sea, my people. So he's saying my, I came from. So these
that's,
are
that's
the
what
fun
I was
rings.
Getting at. Yeah. Yeah, they that's what it sounds to me like, that actually Patchface may actually have seen the what is George is using in this respect is the Fomorians for the drowned gods. You know, how they take the men's seed. The women down there would take the men's seed. And so there possibly is a whole world down there that we don't know about. And that brings us back to, in a way, Bloodraven. Because if you're talking about the elements, water and fire, what's the other one? Earth and water, fire
and air.
Air, yes, air for the fire. When you're talking about the elements there, you've got the water element already there. So if there's an earth being, and I would think that Bloodraven would go in, will be among that deity. And then you have the water-based deity, which would be the drowned god deity. And then you have the god, which would be the Lord of Light. So you're really getting these gods with all these different, am I correct, in a way?
I think so. I think that, I mean, I was just shocked to read all this, that the, you know, in the world of ice and fire, the children of the forest and the first men make a pact. And the Malaysians or the Andals sort of are still, they still don't quite pack. They don't keep to it as much as the first men and the children. They're not bonded like that, like the two of them are. So it seems like he took a little bit of it and switched it around. But yeah, it seems like the people who landed and they even since they lived on the sea, they didn't, and they reaved instead of sowed. So I think that they did go, and it says that they went under the sea, and that they might be Lemuria or Atlantis, where the blue eyes came from. They could be partly the others. I don't know. But they seem more like the others than anyone else to be changed. So I think there is an army under the sea, basically. I think, because I will lead it. I'll lead him in and out of the waves. I think he's not really... The boy that Stefan Baratheon found and said was so brilliant wrote the letter to Maester Crescent saying maybe he can even make Stannis laugh. He speaks four languages. He's so brilliant. That boy did not make it back. It was Patchface that made it back. And the motley on his face is blue and, or is red and green. There's the other two colors. If he's got blue eyes, I wouldn't be surprised. Know what Patchface's eyes eye color is, but seems like the drowned god might have sent someone in place of that boy.
I'll jump in. I just was listening for so long. I gathered so many notes. I do believe that the Faith of the Seven does have something to do with the characters in the book, whether that is a stark, just a generalization of the POVs or the tertiary characters in the books. I did mention the Grey King here, which you kind of brought up, and how it matches the others, and how he had 100 sons, and how, like, he married half-breed people and all this stuff, like mermaids and then humans and intermingled and everything like that. As for the color eyes, the thing that gets me with John is, or Bran, is that John is supposed to, if he's a Targaryen, supposed to have lilac eyes, but he gets the gray eyes of the Starks, or the, I think they're darker, I think they're referred to as onyx in the books, which is also something that relates to the dragons when Arya's in the Red Keep. She sees them and she refers to the bones as onyx, which is weird to me that they would be referred to that color and not like a white color, like an opal color. As for the oaths, this is what gets me too here, because Mirror and Jojen spout all these oaths, and although they're spouting, whether they're spouting it to the right person is debatable, right? I think they should have spouted it to John, because although Bran is a Greenseer and he is the heir to Winterfell currently, it's not the true king of that region. So, and this also goes into Jaime and how you can never really keep your oaths. You can't keep all of them. So it's also prophesizing that John is going to have to pick who's going to get the worst of it. Is it going to be stone? Is it going to be water? Is it going to be air? Is it going to be fire? Is it going to be ice? Like, who's going to get the pointy end of the stick, for a better term? As for the races that you were talking about, every time I kept thinking of that, I kept thinking about Ursula Upcliffe, who was she was an Andal sorceress. She was in the Vale region for Royce, and supposedly his hungry tongue convinced her. But there are moments where other races jump ship. They say, no, like, this isn't right. We're not supposed to be doing this to each other in this new region. And this also relates back to the Black Blood, which Craster has. And then also, I think it's the Harren lines of the Iron Islands have, which refers back to the Grey King. And yeah, it's just a lot of points. Wondering if the taint that the Iron Islands has, the Black Blood, and Craster has, is a taint that may hinder John and may make him break his oath in this process. That's what I've gathered from just you talking.
Okay, I'm going to jump in here too, because to me there's another element. I wish I had noted down where in the video I got this, but I've got here that authors can also use tornadoes and natural disasters to remind us all that we are not in control. And I wonder sometimes we're missing a point with all these wars that are going on, and you've got these gods and the natural elements. We're forgetting that there is nature, that could be a payback. They can have a payback too. Like, the people have devastated the land through their own internal conflicts and ambitions, and that nature itself will also come back at them, because we cannot control what is not within our capabilities, and that is nature itself. And nature reminds us of this. We can build, but nature can tear it down. In other words, we can build a house, and if there's a tornado, it'll tear it down. It is a rejuvenation. I kind of thought about, in Australia, our biggest fear here is fire. So even though fire can race through the hills like it did here many, many years ago, and it's a blackened land, you can still see elements of rejuvenation. But before that rejuvenation happens, there is disaster. But even in the disaster, you're in the midst of life. And I think what nature destroys, new life will restore. We're not the creator, but rather created. So even though the world is ours, this is a kind of different world. And in this world, and also in our world, we're also part of a kind of like a sinew of the body of nature. We exist as part of the fabric of nature. We're not an element on its own. We actually have to live with nature if we're meant to be at peace and if the land is to grow and to be prosperous. But we are never in control of it. And I wonder too if this is nature getting back at what man has inflicted upon it, as I said, with its wars and its conflicts and its personal ambitions.
Yeah.
Any thoughts?
I'd love to say something if I could, but if somebody else wants to go, please do. I've been talking a lot.
I'd like to just jump in a little bit. As far as all of the religions and everything, I think you're going to find that they'll all come together to defeat the great others, and that the religion of the seven would equal the air, Lord of Light would equal fire, the water would equal the drowned god, and the children of the forest would be the earth. And you would have the four elements, and represented by four different religions, they would all come together in order to defeat the great other with Jon Snow, prince that was promised, or Azor Ahai. You know, that still remains to be seen. But I still think that Bran is the last hero. That's it.
That's great, Nan. It really is, because we've got it all. It's all there for us. We've got the three heads of the dragon that are definitely red, blue, and green. The trident has a red fork, a blue fork, and a green fork. The trio statue in Braavos that Arya was looking at with the sailor's wife, and that Tyrion was looking at with Penny. It's red and blue. So the green is the nature, I think, and it's the children. Also, I think, I mean, the way I see it is that probably a force of nature that remind people when they've forgotten the original pact was. The, you know, it's like, where's everybody getting all this from? Where's Rhaegar getting all these prophecies from? Probably from the ghost of Highheart or Ilk, which is probably the children of the forest. So, you know, where did he get the Song of Ice and Fire? Where did he get these things from? Most likely at Summerhall. What I get from it is that, yes, nature, it'll take everything. And legends say that, you know, I mean, there was a great flood. All religions, there was a flood. There were people who survived that flood. You know, certain religions say who it was, who it wasn't. But there's only a certain amount of people that were said to survive these floods. So it seems like those people, the bloodlines on, or started the bloodlines, because I think we're still playing out gods here. Characters are gods. They're playing out the gods, what the gods did. The story is about us, I think. And calls it Earth. I know a lot of people call it Planetos, but in these books, every time he names the planet, it. So it feels to me like they're there to remind everybody that they've forgotten. They come when the Earth is in danger again, just like the red grass field. How many times can you soak the Earth with blood before something happens? So it's almost like the children can create the natural disasters, the earth can create the natural disasters. Are the others just a race that remind them? From the south to the north, all of the houses that lead up that are really ancient houses, their sigils say things like, "We light the way, we remember. We, the old, the brave, the true," things like that, all the way up. So it's like it's going from the south to the north. Dawn went from the south to the north.
Okay, I'll jump in. When you were bringing up how George R. R. Martin is basically telling... I'm echoing, I think.
Did you mute?
Okay,
have you muted? That's okay.
Okay, so when I was... I'm still echoing. Sorry. When I was looking into it, like when you were talking, I kept thinking of the Last of the Giants song, which stole the fish from our river. Let me just look at it. Oh, the small folk have stolen my forests, they've stolen my rivers and hills, and they built a great wall through my valleys and fish all the fish from my rills. And it goes on to mention the stone and so on and so forth. So I believe that's correct. As for the blood on the land itself, I believe that's necessary. I believe populations need to go through a natural order of things. And in order to do that, there needs to be war. But that's just a personal perspective. But that's how, if the theory is true about Widow's Wail and Oathkeeper, basically when Sansa is in, it's like the Red Keep where the Battle of the Blackfyre was going on. When that was going on, Sansa realizes that Ilyn Payne has her father's sword, but he hasn't wiped the blood off of it. And when I was looking into like Lightbringer and the Fiery Sword, and I went off on a tinfoil theory that basically kind of led somewhere, but led nowhere. And I believe that's what changed the hues of that sword and are what making it so powerful. So I believe it's also necessary in a book perspective as well. And those are my points, but it's,
it's a good point, Steffi.
I love that. Do you want to go, please?
Yeah, I go way back here to what you were talking about a long time ago. And the Weirwood tree and the Ironwood tree and stuff back there. I have a question because I know I've read it and I don't know. How's the black and white? That black door is made out of. Is it made out of ironwood or is it made out of ebony?
Well, Arya calls it ebony, but on the crypts is called ironwood. And so I don't know if just doesn't know the name of it or if it is, if there are two different woods. I don't see why there would be, though. Because the statues in the House of Black and White are made of what she calls cedar wood. These trees that are black with the blue leaves, I don't know that they have a name. I just call them ironwood because they seem like the ironwood stump, the beheading stump at Winterfell, the door in the crypts is ironwood.
If those trees are black with the blue leaves, they're the ones that help the Hand Dying, and they make the stuff they drink, right?
Yeah, you're right. That's what I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree too.
My second point is something that you just said there about the blood-soaked ground, and I think that has a lot to do with it. The blood soaking into the earth from all of these fights and all of these battles is going to have a happens. I mean, you can't put that much blood and let it soak into the earth without the earth or the spirit of the earth or whatever rebelling and coming back. There's going to be a consequence of that much war, of that much fighting, of that much blood spill. There's got to be a consequence. I mean, as humans, they're supposed to be guardians and they're destroying what they're supposed to be guarding, basically.
If I may. Okay. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, we had one other point, and it was not even on topic. It was the blue-eyed thing. I'm going to have to check and see. I'm going to have to start questioning my family because my father had brown eyes, and my mother had brown eyes, my father had blue eyes, and I've got blue eyes. You have to have two blue-eyed parents to have a blue-eyed child. I got to start asking some questions.
I was going to say on that, as far as the blood soaking into the ground and everything, you know, it's kind of biblical, that part is, because, you know, tells Cain, says, I hear the blood of your brother crying from the ground. So, you know, yeah, if there's that much blood soaked into the ground from the War of Five Kingdoms, all of the things that the red and the greens, all of the wars and everything, and there's still being blood spilled over in Meereen and all things over there. So that just reminded me of that.
I also kind of wondered if it's empowered the old gods with the soaking of the blood in the ground, because I'm sure back in the earlier days there was blood sacrifice, because Bran has that vision of the lady with a sickle, was it? And she's near the weirwood tree, she's going to cut the throat, and I'm wondering with all that blood, straight face, said all that blood, all that blood soaking in the ground, would that have empowered the old gods?
So I think so. I did a video where I implied that Ned cleaning off that sword in the godswood in the pool did activate the blood. It was blood. Yeah, I really think either it was then or it was when Ned was beheaded on the steps of Baelor, because Baelor is a huge name in Celtic mythology also. It's a big deal to kill Baelor. So Ned getting killed on those steps and saying that word, you know, every Stark says a name when they die. Rob said mother and Grey Wind. John said ghost and stick him with the pointy end. Ned said Baelor. And we always thought it was just because Arya was on the statue of Baelor and he wanted Yoren to know where she was so he could grab her and take her and see him be beheaded. Something a little different, because Baelor is very, very magical in Celtic. He's actually of the evil eye is what he's called. So he has an eye in the back of his head and an eye in his third eye. He can actually burn the field behind him. He has a lot of different powers, but Baelor, right before he was killed, I think that's what might have activated the magic. If it weren't the blood before that in the godswood, that's what did it. And then, really quickly, that's really interesting I didn't know that that's what Cain said in the Bible. Is it Cain that said that? I hear your brother crying from the ground.
God said that to Cain. You know, he God was said, still talking. Yeah, I hear your brother's blood crying from the ground. Yeah.
That's so interesting that is...
Well, the thing... never mind, I forgot what I was going to go in with that. Go ahead.
I just think that's brilliantly interesting because that ties right back to the Redgrass Field and killing Bittersteel and his son in a terrible way. He really, I mean, he did a terrible thing. He shot Bittersteel in the eye in the back, or in the, I don't remember. He shot him in the eye, but then one of them was crawling towards the other one. I think it was his son crawling towards him, and he shot him also. with an arrow. So now, that blood soaking into the red grass field, that really makes me think of what you said. I hear your brother crying from the ground. Mance Rayder taking the name of Abel when he comes to Winterfell. That all has to tie together somehow.
There's references in mythology about blood speaking. Isn't there also about blood? Blood. I remember that from somewhere about the blood speaking. Blood speaks truth.
Yeah.
I can't remember where it's from though, but I remember that blood speaks truth when people lie.
Right.
Yeah. Also, you know when Bloodraven killed in the Blackfyre Rebellion and all of this was going on, you had the greens and the reds and all of this. All of that was kinslaying. And you know, that could have been what led to the end of the Targaryen. They were cursed in that respect because of the kinslay. Because that was still in high regard, if not by the Targaryens, at least by the old gods that were still there at that time, the few that were there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's one of the things in the world of Ice and Fire that says, you know, Night and his demons were the people on the other side of the Five Forts acting, doing things like kinslaying and incest and murder and coveting the neighbor's wife and things like that.
History repeating itself, honey.
Yeah, and I think that's the spirals too, you know, just repeating and repeating and repeating. Oh, and the other thing I wanted to say really quickly about the circles that I think is really interesting is I wonder, you know, when the others kill and they leave the pattern of the, it makes me wonder if they're mocking the gods. They might be, because maybe they were made from the children or made by the children from, or the Andals in the show. If that's true, or even if it isn't true, they don't leave blood and they leave this spiral, you know, body parts. And they, when they kill, they mock and they laugh. That's what Waymar Royce said. So I'm wondering if they're mocking the gods or if they're mocking the children. Yes, the green seers impaled on the spires. That might be it, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. The green seers have been impaled in the ice spires by the White Walkers. And like I said in that video, you know, if Bloodraven is in the tree, has the tree running in and out of him, and these others have the green seers with ice running in and out of them, the green seers' abilities on that. That's the one thing I was thinking of on that.
That's a great tie-in. I love that. It's a really great tie-in.
Okay, so I'm making notes again because we're talking. So when it comes to Bran's vision with the lady in the sickle, every time I was reviewing that scene, all I kept thinking about was White Tree, where that the weirwood almost can fit a lamb in there. I think that's what John says. And that is the hometown, technically, or where Craster's mother lived before he moved to his keep. So I find that really weird, and again, it brings up the blood and the correlation with this whole thing on blood. As for the cycle, when you brought that up, instantly I thought of the Morgan, and how she's kind of, depending on where you go, she's A, the Phantom Queen, and then she's kind of also like a Valkyrie, where she might raise the dead from back to life. So that might be another thing. As for, again, the colors of the eyes, people keep talking about this in the chat. And when we brought it up, the blue eye color, blue eyes aren't actually blue. It's much like the sky is not blue. It's depending on the light source. So technically, they're basically just white, empty sockets. So when I was thinking about that, all I kept thinking is, when Bran wargs, like, it's more described in the show, where you actually physically see it, where in the books, you don't see his eyes when he wargs. You don't know if they, like, flip over or they turn whatever color, but they go white. So it makes me think that whoever has these blue eyes is actually either being warged, like Hodor is, or to some respect is a Greenseer and does have that ability, despite the red and the green and all these other colors. Yes, that's my thoughts on the situation as it stands. I just think, yeah, Ashley, and that's true too, that the Morgan is a three-headed deity, which it's basically, it's kind of like in the Greek mythology, where the sisters switch eyes and they give it to each other, and each of them sees the future to, or the past or the present to some extent. So, yeah, I'm with you on that one. So, but again, it's that fragile line where it can be snipped at any moment, right? So which one of these elements is going to be snipped in the end is what I was basically getting at way before, and even now I just keep coming back to that.
It's a good point, because, you know, one of them has to be. I mean, I think maybe we have Paris to thank for not finding Arya in the spring with Clutching Needle after the snow thaws, I hope. But, you know, that might be the element that's taken out. Is that would mean Jon. But see, Jon should be a sand. That right there is a little bit of what confuses me with the whole snow thing. It's evil because it's not really his name.
Well, his name yet, though, Ashley, because it's not been revealed in the show or the book yet, his true name. And, as you know, for all we know, Rhaegar may have married Lyanna, and he may be a true-born son.
Yeah, I think he might be. What I meant is that he should be a sand for where he was born. Since he was born in Dorne, he should be a sand, not a snow.
Yeah, that's true, but I don't think Ned would have let that happen, because it probably would have given the cat away, or the wolf in this sense.
Right. Yeah, true. Yeah, I but was just trying
just,
to.
It just for a second. It just brings up one thing to my mind is Ramsay Snow. If you like, with Snow equals evil. Well, that is actually Ramsay Snow's name is Ramsay Snow, the epitome of evil.
Excellent point, Marie.
Okay, so I found that quote about what Ash was talking about, and when it comes, again, that's going back to the eye colors and everything, but there's a dream, Jon has a dream, and at the end of the dream he says, A light has gone out somewhere, and he says, "Egret," he whispered, "forgive me, please, but it was only a dire wolf, gray, ghastly, spotted with blood, his golden eyes shining sadly through the dark." Now, every time I see a color in the book, I instantly think of dragon glass now, or the obsidian candles, and how they take colors and make them differently, too. So that might also hint to something, like red seems like a flame. Yellow is gold. So when you're looking at eye colors like blue, it could be an ocean or something like that, to that extent. But that being said, hold on, you can go.
Steffi, that's awesome. It's totally true, because there's a lot of instances in the book where they don't say alive with light specifically about which color, but now that I've been looking, I've found that they say it's alive with light, and then a sentence goes by and it'll say it's indigo light. Every color is alive in some way. The way dawn is, you know, the way that they say it's alive with light. There's House of the Undying, where Daenerys says she sees a lilac, it's alive with light, and then it's indigo light. And then when, I can't remember what it was, something was alive with emerald light, and I can't remember what that was, but I've been finding those a lot. So you're right, the colors are huge. And every time I see the colors, I think of the peacock's tail of alchemy. I think of rose. I think it has to do with spiritual perfection. I always say that, I know, but what we're shooting for here. A god king, like a pharaoh.
When I think of the colors, though, I think of the glamour stones that Andra has. And, you know, when you look back, Shiara Seastar had one blue eye and one green eye. And she wore an emerald and a sapphire. And, you know, that emerald and sapphire could have been a form of glamouring in and of itself, too.
I'd like to jump in on that really quickly. Okay, when you brought that up, Nan, I instantly thought again of the dragon glass candle, because three are black and one is green. So you wonder if Bran having these three eyes is equivalent to this one person having that one different colored eye. And whether that's blue now is up to debate. Because I always figured it was the one blue eye that everyone was talking about. Maybe it's a green eye we should be looking for.
Maybe so, Steffi. Maybe so.
Yeah.
The kind of thing, that was a good thing to point out. It's not something that I really thought of. When that passage that you read there, see, that's the pragmatist in me. I just read that as in, that's when Rob died. And he saw Rob and he saw Grey Wind. Well, he saw the light went out, that was Rob. And what he saw, the dire wolf, he saw was Grey Wind. So that's just the pragmatist in me. And I just passed over the color thing altogether. So I'm not going to go back and pay more attention to that.
It's interesting.
Yeah, when John is in that dream, he sees the golden eyes. He doesn't see green eyes, so it can't be Grey Wind, because Grey Wind has green eyes. If we're referring to the dragon glass, yellow turns into gold. The golden eyes belong to Nymeria, and the yellow eyes belong to Summer. So it's either or, right? It can't. So when Ashley brought up Arya being found in the snow, that's what I was referring to. that maybe she wore to Nymeria, and that's where she's at the current time, and maybe that the colors do change depending on the situation that they're in, right?
Well, John makes a statement about finding her in the spring in the snow with needle clasped in her hand. That sentence has always bugged me, that about finding her in the spring after the snows with needles still clutched in her hand. That sentence has always bugged me.
Glad I could help.
Well, it's bugged me too, but it's bugged me because I'm afraid that that's exactly what's going to happen to her. And I don't want that to happen. I want her to live through it.
I'd also like to bring up another point. When it comes to Ashley's theory, every time she brought up like water or another element, all I kept thinking about was the mist. Well, let me try to find the quote for a second. Here it is. Okay, it's in A Clash of Kings, Cat 4, and it says, the night fires had burned low, and as the east began to lighten, the immense mass of storms ended like a dream of stone, while whiffs of pale mist raced across the field. And these pale mists end up to be everywhere. I'm talking about Harrenhal, Mokeel, and the fork of the Trident, or one of the Tridents where Tyrion is at, that ends up to be there. You're talking about the Haunted Forest, like everywhere. It's scattered throughout this book entirely. Okay, so, and basically, Kat says, she refers to it as the morning ghost, and she hears this from Nan, right? And she says that basically their spirits returning to their graves. So it's also that theme of resurrection in this hero's story of ghosts, because ghost is also referred to as this mist of snow, or this mist, because he kind of blends into that environment perfectly. Right, if it wasn't for his red eyes, you wouldn't see him at all. So yeah, just tinfoil.
Well, when you're talking about the mist, Steffi, that kind of reminds me of Arthur and the wizard. You know, with the fog and the mist that come out, and Uther and the fog out Merlin in the mist of Merlin. And so that's he's a magical earth element, I would think. And so that could go back to that.
Yeah, if I'm unmuted, I'd love to say something about that. Because it's funny, I was just thinking about Merlin and what part, you know, before, I think this is a huge, especially the John part with Rhaegar and Lyanna. It's all story. So, you know, Uther Pendragon, his father, just like Rhaegar, he carried red dragon banners. He was the Dragon King. And his wife was named Egraine, with a Y. So, Gret. And I think that this is where he got a lot of this, this is where he took a lot of this from. And Merlin, actually, in a lot of stories, spent the man in the oak tree. I feel like Bloodraven's a mix of Loki. That's why he's kind of a trickster. But he also can sort of, he can become the mist, he can become it's interesting when you hear mist, it makes me think of Bloodraven also, and it makes me wonder if he's going for John, because John is the one he should be looking for.
Okay, I'll jump in. When you brought up the mist again, I also thought of Bran's vision, like his first vision of where he sees everything through a mist, right? So again, it's referring back to this Brynden Rivers is ghost and all this stuff, and just amazing.
Actually, I think that's a good thought. You know, you go, we always seem to go back to Bloodraven, Brynden Rivers. Yeah. And it seems like we have so much to get onto with that. And we're hoping to be doing some of that before long. Yeah, I think we've all made some really good points here tonight. And ladies, I think that it's an amazing book. Ashley, you got something else you want to add, huh?
No, I'm great. Thank you, though, Nan, for asking. I appreciate it.
Ladies, anybody else?
I just want to make one more point, which I picked up in Ashley's vid, and that's the bears and the wolves. I pointed out that the Mormonts did not break faith with the Starks. But when the Starks broke faith, when Rob broke his word and did not marry the Frey wife, he paid for it. And he suffered for it with the death of Rob, and everyone in the North suffered as well. So there's kind of a connection there that between the bears and the wolves. The bears kept faith and the wolf didn't and suffered for it. So I'm praying to God John keeps his bloody word in everything he does. But it is getting on. So Nan, did you want to say a few words? I just wanted to remind you of the time. For me, it's daylight, so it doesn't worry me, but I know you ladies have to go to work the next day.
That's up to the girls, y'all. Tell me what to do. I'm good here for now. It's up to you girls.
Okay, I could go on or I could go off. Yeah.
I could push it a little. Just because we're on a tangent right now and I don't want to stop.
Yeah, I like the tangent too. Something to say about the bears and the wolves. You just reminded me of that, Marie. Uther of Pendragon was called the Old Bear. And I find it interesting that the first sort of real father figure besides Ned that John had was the Old Bear, Jor Mormont. He gave him Longclaw. I mean, that's huge. That's in King Arthur's stories, Uther is the bear, and it seems strange, but once you get here, it makes perfect sense. Also, Varamyr Sixskin said that it was easier to get to warg into his, or to skin change into his bear, life in the bear, than it was in anything else, I think.
That might be why the bears of Mormont women are, say they're bears.
Right, and the Starks did give Bear Island to the Mormonts. That's why they're so behind the Starks in every way. And yeah, I think the women of Bear Island have a lot of meaning behind them. Besides the fact that they're wonderful.
I think the whole blood
talk about the colors. Okay.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Go ahead, Faye.
No, that's okay. She can go ahead. I was just gonna. Talking about Bloodraven. He's fascinating to me because history in general, up to that point, and the whole, you know, his pale skin, his red eyes, and those pale fur, and his red eyes, and it just, there's a lot of that theme over and over. But Bloodraven is fascinating to me because you never quite know. I mean, you always. You never quite know what he is or what his ideas are, because some of the stuff he did when he was like the Hand, some of the stuff he did was kind of questionable, but it was for a good purpose. And now it's the same thing. And it always takes me back to Old Man and her Crows Are All Liars thing. And it just, I don't know. There's just something that I can't quite trust him. He's got an answer, it doesn't matter, but I just can't quite trust him.
Jumping into Ashley's point about the old bear, you also have to realize that whatever's like controlling Mormont's Raven might also be Brendan Rivers, which is also a huge correlation to the whole cycle of leading back to Brendan Rivers. All right.
Very true.
Oh, I agree, Steffi. I really think that's the case. I think that bird is being warred by Brendan Rivers. And Brendan Rivers is such an, like you said, Faye, you just don't never really know for sure where he's coming from. But not only his eye color and his being an albino, but you've got to look at the birthmark. So it's almost like he was tagged at birth when you look at the crow on his face.
Yeah.
Following with Nat Ashley's theory there on the elements and everything, you also got to think about how Brendan Rivers is also from, he's a Blackwood. So you have to also think of the werewolf tree and the possibility of it turning to stone. And that may be possible with Brendan Rivers if he dies in that werewolf tree at some point, that it could turn to stone and seize that connection.
That's Steffi, because all of the myths have the guy, have the man in the tree coming out of the tree at the end of the whole whatever it is that happens, you know, whether it's a flood, a fire, whatever. Usually the old man in the tree, Merlin, the green man, they come out of the tree. But it would be apropos for George to have him stay in the tree and it turn to stone.
And this
well,
also
the TV show's already got, the TV show's also got, already got Bran coming out. You know, so, you know, that's most likely in the books, he's probably going to come out too, because Hodor part was one of the few things that did surprise, that they really freaked D&D out about.
Yeah, that was one of the one few parts that came from George was... At least in season 6. He will hold the door.
Okay, I'm just going to jump in quickly. This also refers to Ashley's theory from a previous video, or I don't know, maybe we weren't recording at the time, where... You gave me an idea about the Naga's bones actually being of weirwood and how they turn to stone, which would also refer to the Grey King and him actually carving the boat and then thus killing it. And that's what's the remnants of it is. That's pretty good. Wow.
Yeah, that's really cool. That's really cool. Because, you know, I mean, it does relate back to the Great Floods, and there would be an ark of some kind Formorians or the Ironborn were to come first. Also something that says maybe Buddhist monks came first. So whoever came first, being the Grey King, is really cool, because some stories, like the Noah's Ark story, say that his own family couldn't get on the boat. Other stories have everybody coming on the boat. I think it's a little odd to leave your family off the boat, but, you know, it is interesting, because there is an actual bones of Naga in mythology also. There's a serpent of Naga that's a three-headed dragon. Oh, I don't know if they're with it or not, but who knows what's under that sea? Who knows what took the ark down?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. Steffi, you got something to add to that?
No, you're okay.
I guess we're gonna try to wind it down a little bit. We'll start over there with Ashley, then Marie, Steffi. No, we're gonna let Faye go first. She's our guest. You, Faye, and give, tell them where they can reach you at, hon.
Good night, everybody. Thank you all for coming and listening to the theories. I'm on Sword in the Darkness, have YouTube channel. I only have about 5 videos out now, but I've got other stuff in the works. It's just been kind of a hectic holiday season, and I kind of had a gap in there, but I'll get back to it. And I appreciate y'all being here. I appreciate these lovely ladies for having me. So y'all have a rest of the week.
It was so nice to have you on, Faye. Nice meeting you. I loved your video so much, and it's a pleasure to meet you. Bye, now that I'm talking. I'm Ashley at The Iron Underneath. I'm going to start making some new videos. Like Faye said, now that the holidays are over, it'll be a little easier. So you can find me at The Iron Underneath on YouTube. Always, thanks for being here.
Marie, you're muted, hon.
Sorry, everyone. I got so busy putting up the links to everyone's sites. Thank you, Faye, for coming along. I was really interested in your theory, and I'm glad you made that vid. I know you had a lot of problems with it, so we're so grateful that you were able to do it in the end. YouTube was being an ass with poor Faye, and like it was with me last week. So I understand you're probably panicking at the last minute, wanting that vid to get up. So thank you very much, hon, for coming along. It's been a really interesting vid. We've loved discussing it. And I have to say, this has been our longest time. So it proves that we had a lot to say about your vid and Ashley's vid. So thank you very much, ladies. And I'll say my goodbyes now to everyone. Love you all. Thanks for coming here. And God bless you. And remember, keep safe, drive carefully, and get home safely. God bless you. And to Steffi's boss, you're an arsehole.
Thanks, Marie. Yes, but thanks, Faye, for coming on here and allowing us to pick our brains about your theory. And it was a blast, and I hope we made it more interesting for our viewers who are in the chat, which are always awesome. Thanks, Ash, for your theory as well. It was just like insane tangents tonight. Like, bombs were dropped, and I am so happy about it. As for the chat, we do have a Q&A coming up, so if you want to just drop the questions in the post comments down below on the page, just do it, and we'll get to it if we can. And I'll see you guys all later. Cheers.
I'd like to thank all of y'all for coming out tonight. Thank you, Faye. We sure appreciate having you. Steffi, Ashley, Marie, I always appreciate you girls every week, every day. And we have enjoyed both of the videos. Ashley, wonderful job. Faye, wonderful job. And we will look forward to having you all come back to see us again next Tuesday at 7:30 p.m. here at the Golden Girls of Westeros. And I'm Old Nan, and you can find me here or at Old Nan on Game of Thrones. And have a wonderful, wonderful week.